Hi, this is Gene DiNapoli. Just want to let you know that your comments tonight might be shown on screen. There in social media land, welcome to episode 58 of a show I created called Reminiscing with Gene DiNapoli. I am once again Gene DiNapoli, hoping that everybody had a great holiday, Thanksgiving Thursday. And before we get underway, a couple words from our sponsors.
Hi, this is Francisco. Many people call me the creative CPA. If you need help with your taxes or financial matters, please email me your cell number and the best time and day to call you. You can email me at francisco@aol.com, and Cisco is spelled S-I-S-C-O, the creative CPA. It's that simple, that easy. Thank you.
Craving a cruise? Perhaps a gorgeous all-inclusive resort, magnificent destination weddings, and stunning, unforgettable honeymoons. Dream Destinations Travels, a cruise planner franchisee, has all your travel and vacation ideas covered with great deals, extensive knowledge, and totally flexible payment plans. Group travel, be it family or friends, is our specialty. Never a charge to our clients and always free, no-obligation quotes. Check our website at sundrenchcruises.com or give us a call at the number above.
Little Italy Auto Repair at 628 Crescent Avenue in the true Little Italy of the Bronx. Over 50 years of automotive service excellence, ASC and state certified, offering all types of services to all types of cars. Discounts to first responders, military, Fordham University students and faculty. All work is done by Victorio with the highest level of quality possible. Telephone number is 718-933-2365 or visit his website at www.littleitalyautobronx.webs.com. That's Little Italy Auto Repair. Thank you very much to our sponsors. We hope that you continue with us into the new year. I want to bring my producer, Anthony Griffo, back on screen. Anthony, could you join us once again? If you could hear us. Anthony, join us. Are you out there, Anthony?
I'm here. Hello.
Can you get on screen, buddy?
Hang on.
Get on screen. I want everybody to say hello to our producer, who does a fabulous job week after week. And I drive this young man out of his mind.
Hi, everyone.
Anthony always says, can you get me Monday night's guest info by Saturday? I get Anthony to stuff Saturday night, Sunday, even Monday. Anthony, I want to tell you, I appreciate your friendship and all the hard work you do.
Thank you.
Anthony, what I want to do right now is I did a show a few weeks ago, a doo-wop show, and I had people fill out comment cards. And I want to give away a pair of tickets to our next doo-wop show in February. So I have 16 comment cards, Anthony. Okay. So I need you to pick out a number 1 through 16, and that's going to be the winner. So close your eyes, Anthony. Think of a number and shout it out.
14.
Okay, 14. Okay. So thanks, Ant. Bye-bye.
All right. Go away
again. Okay, so we're going to count 14 from the top. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. 14 is our winner. We have two left. It was 16. And the winner of the two tickets, I love when you say, please print, and they don't. So this is, I believe it's TeganXXL at gmail.com. TeganXXL at gmail.com. You are the winner of the two tickets. I will email this person. If they don't get back to me, we're going to throw it in the garbage because the words, please print, must not have been big enough because they wrote it in script and I could not for the life of me read it. So we're going to hopefully we get that to the winner of the two tickets to the February doo-wop show. Thank you so much. So we did a couple of promotion shows this past weekend in Yonkers. I had the very beautiful freestyle singer, Cynthia, at a disco freestyle show while myself went to Poughkeepsie and hung out with the son and percussionist extraordinaire, Tito Puente Jr. Anthony put up that picture of me and Tito. There's me and Tito in the dressing room. We had a great show, and it's the first of many that we'll be doing with Tito, who keeps his father's music alive. Tito, thank you for your friendship and for working everything that you did with me. You're a gentleman and a scholar. Okay, so I wish I could read my own handwriting. Okay, so this week is filled with a couple of private shows, but next week we have three shows in a row we want to talk about. One, a friend of mine is producing on Saturday, December 11th at Stepanak High School. There'll be a doo-wop spectacular. Anthony put up that first flyer. There you go. With the Brooklyn Bridge, Kids Kyle, Bobby Wilson, Jackie DiMaggio, Jimmy Russo, and the Chords, Classic Sounds, and Sean and Valerie. Will be performing, hosted by Dennis Dion Nardone. You can click that flyer or see the number 914-424-8814 for tickets. And tell Nikki C. Gene DiNapoli sent you. Okay, then the next day, I'm producing a doo-wop dinner dance at the Royal Regency Hotel starring the Bel Airs and Still in Style. It's $65 a ticket. That includes a 3 or 4 course dinner, tax and tip and show included. I don't know about you, but where are you going to go for $65 other than McDonald's and get a dinner, 2 great groups, and dancing? Starts at 6 o'clock, December 12th. Go to www.royalregencyshows.com to buy your tickets there. If you have questions, you can call me. But I'd rather you go right to the website. And then on Monday, I am bringing to the White Plains Performing Arts Center one of the funniest comedians and one of the most talented vocalists I know. We are bringing the Italian Broadway Christmas show starring Anthony Nunziata and Regina DiCicco to the White Plains Performing Arts Center on Monday, December 13th at 7:30. Now, Regina is a breakout comedian who I've seen many times, and we want her to be a part of our show. And Anthony Nunziata was one half of the Nunziata Boys, who is now on his own. You could also might have seen him on the Columbus Day Parade on Channel 4, it was. He was the first artist to sing on the parade. And we want to thank Anthony and Regina. They will be with us December the 13th, www.wppac.com for your tickets. We'll talk about that later. Okay. So a few weeks ago, I had on a gentleman on my show that I revered. I revered this man so much because not only did he have a dream And not only did he make that dream a reality, his song was my parents' wedding song. 1979, he came out with a song called Do I Love You? 1980, my mother and my father, Louie, married. And I remember hearing this song at their wedding, and I fell in love with it. And when I subsequently did shows that I didn't do Elvis, I would always sing this song. It was a very great song. Well, I happened to meet that gentleman through not only my friend Paul Arante, but the gentleman's son. And I heard of this young man, and I knew him vaguely. He liked Elvis. He liked this. And I said, okay, there's got to be more to this guy than just what I see. So we made him our guest tonight. And he is what we call a keeper of the flame. We had Chris Ruggiero on the show, who does the music of the 50s and 60s. This gentleman does the same thing. They're both songwriters. They're both great performers. But we're going to let the commercial that we're going to show you right now speak for yourself, speak for itself, because in order to be on a commercial with the next group, you know you're good. Hit it, Anthony.
An American classic, The Four Tops. From the back streets of the Motor City to the front page of American music history, the legendary Four Tops, with special guest Peter Lemongello Jr., as seen on American Idol. Come relive the hits of one of Motown's most enduring artists. Sunday, December 12th, Sunrise Theater. Get tickets at sunrisetheater.com or 772-461-4775.
Okay, so you might be friends with a group, but when you got a group as powerful as the Four Tops, you better be damn good to be on the same stage. And this kid is good, and I'm proud to call him my friend. Ladies and gentlemen, bring in our guest tonight, Mr. Peter Lemongello Jr. Hey, Petey.
Hey, Gene.
What's up, buddy?
Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, listen to me. I got to tell you something. The more I dug into your career, the more fascinated I was with what you do. So we had to bring you on. We had to bring you on because, you know, listen, I got to tell you the truth. I don't think anybody, any child should go into the same business as their parents when their parents were great at what they did. But you do have exceptions to the rule. You have Cal Ripken Jr. You have Dale Earnhardt Jr. You got
Natalie and Nat King Cole.
Mm-hmm. Then you got you, and
thank you.
You do a great job. Unfortunately, Natalie and her father are male and female, so there is a dichotomy there. You're going into a business where your father was great, and you're a male. You're trying to do your own thing. So what we want to do over the next 45, 50 minutes is let Peter get to know, people get to know who Peter Lemongello Jr. is. Because I'm fascinated that your career started at 3 years old.
Yeah, that's right.
You got to tell me how this happened.
Well, I was at, it was in New Jersey, and I was at my dad's show. And I was with my mom in the towards the back of the theater. And my dad started going into his last song, which was New York, New York. Mm. And my mom said I was always, you know, I was always into the music that, I'd always be moving when music was playing. And so he starts this last song, and I somehow got away from my mom and just ran towards the stage. And my dad saw me coming, and he picked me up, and we started singing New York, New York together.
Now, is this the exact, is this the actual show?
That is it.
That's it.
That's it.
And your mom took this picture?
No, actually, I think some of the fans in the audience took it.
I love your stage wear. You were definitely getting ready to go on stage. Now, your father mentioned when you started singing that you blew him away as well. So was this like unbeknownst to everybody in the family?
Yeah. Yeah. My dad, you know, I guess nobody expected it. I don't really remember it. But from what they told me, you know, my dad was trying to like keep me face backwards because he didn't want me to see this big crowd and get, you know, overwhelmed. And but I just turned and looked at the crowd and I kept singing. And my dad said, well, you know, he's he's not afraid. He's not intimidated about being on stage.
So you were 3 years old.
Yeah.
This picture, you're a little older.
Yes, that was at the Hilton in Atlantic City, I believe.
And was that during a sound check or you were actually on stage?
Yes. I think that's the sound check.
Right, right. And so did your father bring you up throughout the shows to perform?
Yes, after that first time, and it went over so well with the audience. I remember everybody was asking my mom, oh, does he do this all the time? And she said, no, you know, this was the first time. But after that, then my dad started bringing me on all the time, and we'd do a song or two together.
And besides New York, New York, what was some of the songs?
Well, we used to do a few songs. I know we used to do, I think Sweet Caroline was one. And we did Can't Help Falling in Love, actually.
Oh, I think I know that song.
Yeah, I'm sure you do.
That brings me to something. You started out as a quasi Elvis impersonator, didn't you?
Yeah, when I was about, 10 years old or something, I really, I guess I was always a fan of Elvis, but I really started, to just get into it. And so I did some Elvis. I started doing a couple songs then by myself in my dad's show, right, which I did some Elvis songs.
I neglected to say at the beginning of the show, which I'll say again at the end, tonight is our last live show for the year, because next Monday's show is going to be pre-recorded. And I have you to thank for getting this next gentleman who's going to be our guest next Monday at 7 o'clock. Because
yes,
I got a legend in my mind. I must have seen them 60 or 70 times. Thanks to you, our guest next Monday is Duke Fahir of the legendary Four Tops. I am so tickled. Thank you for putting it together, Peter. I can't thank you enough. We're going to be recording that, airing it 7 o'clock Monday. And then we're going to take the rest of the year off because with Christmas parties and our own shows.
Right.
And then we're going to come back in the new year with a bang. But the commercial we played at the beginning of the show, introducing you, is a show you're going to be doing on the 12th
yes.
of December.
Mm-hmm.
So tell me how Peter Lemongello Jr. winds up on the same stage as the Four Tops.
Well, I would say I knew the Tops very well, and you know, I'd become very good friends with them. And they knew I was a singer, and they knew who my dad was and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember when I got with the Crests and I was singing lead with them. You know, they saw the PBS show and they said, you know, that's great. And, you know, keep going. But I think when I was actually on the Idol, American Idol, I did one of the songs I did, the one they showed on television was I Can't Help Myself.
Right.
Four Tops. Right. So, you know, I told Duke first before I told really anybody. I said I had been with them. We filmed that American Idol on a Sunday, and I had been with the Tops on that previous Friday in Atlantic City. So I told Duke, I said, after I leave here tonight, I'm heading to New York City and I'm going to film, I'm going to be on American Idol and I'm going to be doing your song. And he couldn't believe it. He said, that's fantastic. When it aired then the following March, they were on their tour bus and they watched the show from the bus and they called me right away and said, you know, you did us proud, man. That was great. After that, then it basically led to one of the guys, Roki, who's the son of original member Lawrence Payton. He called me up and said, we're coming down to Florida next month. And, you know, you have to come meet us in Orlando because I'm going to bring you on stage to do I Can't Help Myself with us. And that was, incredible feeling to be on stage with legends like that.
You know,
and then after that,
go
ahead.
Talking about legends, never mind that they were legendary as singers. They are the longest original lineup group in American music history. We're talking about,
that's true.
Of course, our guest next Monday, Duke. We're talking about Obie on the bass. We're talking about Lawrence.
and we're talking about one of the greatest lead singers to ever walk on planet Earth, Mr. Levi Stubbs, the Four Tops. Right now, we're going to show that clip that you took the world by storm on American Idol. So, Anthony, let's run that clip. Peter Lemongello Jr.
Sugar pie, honey bunch, you know that I love you. I can't help myself. I love you and nobody else. In and out of life, you come and you go.
Come and you go.
Leaving just your picture behind. And I've kissed it up.
Unbelievable. I love the fancy footwork. Fancy footwork. I loved it.
Yeah, well, when I finished, Lionel Richie said to me, he goes, man, he says, I have to tell you, those are the exact routines.
And he would know, because they were all label mates at one time.
Yes, that's right. When he was with the Commodores, they were on Motown.
So, out of the thousands of songs out there to pick, I'm not being racist. I'm not, believe you me. How does a white kid from Florida with roots in American standard music pick a Motown classic to be your audition on American Idol?
Wow. Okay, so that's a good question. You know, it's funny because that song has a little more history with me personally, because when I was a baby in the crib, my parents used to come in, they used to sing that song to me. They had a teddy bear that used to play it, and they would change, instead of Sugar Pie Honey Bunch, they'd say Petey Pie Honey Bunch, and they'd sing that to me when I was in the crib.
That's great.
So that's how, I guess that's how I first, it's probably one of the first songs I knew. But, you know, I love a lot of R&B and soul. I mean, I'm pretty versatile. I like a lot of the early rock and roll hits and R&B hits and Motown groups and all that. So I think when I was going on the Idol, I wanted to have, they had me prepare three songs, which I did. I did three songs for them. Obviously, they cut it down to fit it on television. So they just showed the one. But I wanted to open with, that was a song I opened with. I wanted to open with a song that I figured everybody would know, because Lionel knew all three of the songs I did. Right. But the other two judges were, you know, a little on the younger side. Mm-hmm. They knew that song. You can see it in the video. They were singing background for me. But then I did a song by the Dan Lears called One Summer Night.
Of course.
Yeah, one of my favorite, group ballads. But see, Lionel was the only one that knew that. The other two judges didn't know the song. Right. And then I did a Jackie Wilson song called That's Why I Love You So. Right. And again, Lionel, of course, knew it. He was singing the background for me, but the other two judges didn't know it. So I felt I Can't Help Myself was good to break the ice, because I knew everybody would know it.
Okay, so you picked three songs. Again, none of them by Anglo-American artists. All done by African-American performers. Who picked these for you? Did your father or your mother give you any advice, or did you do it on your own?
Well, I believe I picked the songs. I ran it by my parents and my dad, especially. And he said, you know, yeah, I think you sound good, and, you know, they're good songs to do. But yeah, I picked it. I guess I lean more towards, you know, a lot of the R&B. I mean, in those days, like a lot of the black songs were R&B, because they would chart. They wouldn't chart as high on the pop charts, but they would make it on the R&B.
Absolutely. And it's funny how it worked out for you, because the other two judges didn't know the songs.
Right.
Let me ask you this. I was never on American Idol. I was on America's Got Talent as an audition, and I froze up. After performing for 38 years in front of thousands of people, I froze up in front of two people. But that's okay. I get past it. Did they approach you? Did you send an audition tape? How did that work out?
One of the people that my dad knows was who used to work for Arista Records, was friends with the guy who's the producer of the show. So he had sent a video, a video of me to the producer.
Okay.
And the producer was really his name is Peter Cohen, and he was very taken by the video, and he said, "Boy," he says, I really want to see this kid. Can we get him to New York?" So the first time I went up was to just for the producers, and I went in the room, and he really enjoyed what I did. And I remember he said, "Boy, it's like somebody from a different time, a different era." You know, we just thought it was very unique. And then I would say that was in September, and the beginning of September. And I would say by the end of September or beginning of October, I got the call that I was going to be going on television. And they said, "Come back October 30th and, you know, you'll film it."
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Now, I don't know if I got my my years mixed up. What came first, American Idol or PBS?
PBS came first. That was we filmed it in December of 2017 in Asbury Park, New Jersey. And it was, it was freezing when we did that. Right. Boy, but it aired in March of 2018, which was exactly 1 year before the Idol aired. The Idol aired March of 19. 1 year before that, I was on PBS. I was singing lead with the Crests.
Okay, let's revisit that. I'm sorry to go out of turn. PBS did a show called Doo-Wop Generations. They yes. sent out a nationwide casting call for young singers who like doo-wop music to pair them with some original artists. Now, not only do you pick one of the most popular songs in doo-wop history, you sang lead with taking over the vocals for one of the most popular singers in doo-wop history.
Right.
Did you set out to do the Crest music? Was that what was done?
Well, actually, it was kind of interesting because I teamed up with the original member from the Crest before the PBS show came about.
Wow.
We had, which I had known him for years. He used to come down here all the time with a guy, an agent that I knew through my dad named Barry Newman, and they used to sing together. So he used to come down here all the time, and I knew him very well for years. And then Barry had passed on several years ago, and Jay didn't really have a group. So it was in 2017, I believe. We'd always kept in contact, but we were talking, and he said, "You know, I want to get back out there. I need a real group together." And he said, can we do something together?" So that was really an honor because, like you said, the Crests are one of the most popular groups from the 50s, and it's very hard to be compared to somebody like Johnny Maestro because he was such a great lead singer, and so many people loved his voice that it's not like if you take a group like the Dubs, we'll say that. You know, people don't look at the current group and compare the lead singer to Richard Blandon as much as somebody would compare the lead singer of the Crest to Johnny Maestro.
Right.
So it was, it was a little, intimidating in a way because I knew, okay, I have to really put my best foot forward and do the songs justice. But it was then the show was filmed in December. So I would say only about October of that year, TJ announced he was looking for young talent for this idea. So I said to JT, I called him. I said, "This is exactly what we are, young talent with the original member." And he said, "Yeah, that sounds great. We got to get in touch with TJ." So I said, "Okay." So I called him up and I said, "I see you're looking to put young talent with the originals." I said, "I've been singing with JT Carter from the Crest." And he said, "Sounds good." He said, you have a video you can send me." So I said, "Sure." So I sent him the video and he said, right after that, he says, "All right," he says, "give me Jay's number. I got to call him and, discuss some ideas." And next thing I know, we were set to go to Jersey to film it in that December.
And you filmed it. I'm just telling our producer what we're going to do. And you did a bang up job for it. You're still with the Crest when there is work, but we're going to let everybody in social media land see the Crest with lead vocals done by Peter Lemongello Jr. on one of the best songs ever recorded for doo-wop or any kind of music that is. The Angels Listen In. Hit it, Anthony.
The angels listened in when they heard me praying. They gave me the whole wide world wrapped up in one little girl, my darling. When the angels sent you.
You know, I think what put you over the edge, Peter, is that you didn't try to be Johnny Maestro.
Right.
Because if you tried it, you and no slur on your talent, you would have failed. Because nobody could be Johnny
Maestro. Yeah, and I always said that going in, that I knew I was going to get a lot of people who were going to compare me. But I always said, I'm not going to try to sound like him. I'm not going to try to, you know, be him. I'm just going to sing the songs, you know. Properly, of course, but I'm just going to sing the songs as me. And, you know, it was great because I got some of the shows we did. I'd have people that I grew up idolizing, like Willie Winfield from the Harptones, who was one of my, you know, my favorite groups were the Harptones. Right. So he came to the show and, he said, boy, he says, you know, that was incredible. He just said, you know, take care of your voice, man. You have some gift. And that was just incredible to hear that from somebody that was one of the, you know, was the lead singer of one of the greatest groups that ever recorded.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And of course, behind you is the great JT Carter, who was a guest on our show. And you have one of my oldest friends there, Ray Ortiz, I noticed.
Oh, yeah.
Ray Ortiz. Me and Ray go back to the days of karaoke. Absolutely. Whose idea was it to put the female voices there as well?
Well, that was TJ's doing, because he always likes to, try to get the records to sound as close to the records,
right.
Which is great because the Crest recorded originally with the Miller sisters.
Yes.
They were behind on Angels Listened In and on 16 Candles. A lot of people don't know that there are actually three female voices on 16 Candles.
Well, one of them was Patricia Vandross.
No.
She wasn't in the group still?
No. She left in right after the Joyce records, which was Juanita's Sweetest One, and then one other record that they cut. But when they switched over to co-ed records, because Billy Dawn Smith was who I had the pleasure of meeting. I went to see him in the nursing home, thanks to Jackie Nunez, who was, you know, taking care of him.
Right.
And but he told us the Miller sisters, Patricia Vandross was out of the group at that point. So they came in, they had the Miller sisters behind on all the real big hits that the Crest had.
Right. What? Growing up, see, this question is kind of weird because you've been around famous people all your life because of your dad.
That's true.
So when you're finally on stage as yourself.
Mm-hmm.
It's a different kind of feeling than being on stage, standing next to your father, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What's the feeling?
Well, that's a good question. I just try to be myself, give it my all, and give the people that came to see the show the best performance possible.
Did you? I know, of course, you learned from your father from watching him at an early age. You said you were an Elvis fan, but did you never saw Elvis live because obviously he was gone.
Oh, yeah. Elvis died 22 years before I was born. So
just a few years, yeah.
Just a few. I missed that. That close.
Yeah, that close. Listen, I was supposed to go see him on the 21st. He died on the 16th. That was close.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Did you keep the ticket, though?
You know what's funny? We returned it because $15 in 1977 was a lot of money, Peter.
Right.
And no, you know, nobody thought of collecting things back in 77. It was, you know, sure, we had three tickets that weren't going to be used. So, you know, they could feed a house for 3 weeks. Besides groups that you know, singers you know, who did you look at and try to take something from? Like, I know you said the Four Tops and your dad.
Well, I would say my influences are, all people that I believe they all died before I was born. So it's not people I could have known personally. Elvis, always loved Elvis. But Jackie Wilson, I thought, you know, that guy was one of the best. I mean, he really was. And then Sam Cooke. I love Sam Cooke.
Wow.
I thought, Sam Cooke was so great. I mean, and he was just as great a writer as he was a singer.
Yeah, true.
Which you don't really see a lot of times. You see some people, they say singer-songwriters, sometimes they're really good songwriters. They can carry a tune, but or the other way around. But Sam Cooke was a phenomenal writer, and he could sing those songs better than anyone.
Absolutely. And social activist as well.
I love, you know, going back a little further, somebody I loved was Mario Lanza. You know, he was great. I'd see his movies on television. Then I always loved Cab Calloway.
Oh my God.
I thought he was great way back. And then one person that I really loved was Al Jolson. Because he was, you know, a lot of people, Jackie Wilson idolized Al Jolson. He got that whole knee drop that Jackie Wilson used to do was inspired from Al Jolson.
Absolutely.
And, you know, George Burns wrote in his book that Al Jolson was the world's greatest entertainer.
Absolutely.
So I love that. And then, you know, of course, like Dean Martin. I mean, he was the king of cool. So those are the people.
So you pick a little bit from everybody and you mix it together and you come up with Peter Lemongello Jr.
Yeah.
I know your father's right there. Is your mother there as well?
She's in the other room.
So it was cute. You were 3, 4, 5 years old. Cute. Kid gets up. It's cute. It's cute. When you turned around and said you wanted to try to do this professionally, were they automatically in your corner or were there some hesitation? No.
They were going to support me, of course, but they did not want, and most singers do not want their kids going into show business. I know Natalie Cole always said that. Nat always said, don't you dare go into the music business. Because I guess, you know, he knew how, like my dad, how, you know, rough it can be at times. Oh, I heard somebody asked, I like any female singers. Sure. I loved... I thought Doris Day was great, you know, in the movies and everything, but she was a great singer. And then I like Della Reese a lot. You know, I started doing what's kind of become like my signature song, which is Don't You Know. And that was originally a Della Reese song.
Right. Wow. Pretty, that's pretty impressive. Those, I mean,
yes. I was just told I'm allowed to announce that I just signed with premier artist with Elliot Wiseman to manage, and he was the man that managed Frank Sinatra, Sammy Davis Jr., Liza Minnelli, Stephen Eady, Don Rickles, Engelbert Humperdinck, Paul Anka, all at the same time.
I might have heard of a few of those people. So is this the first time you're publicly saying this?
Yes. I didn't
Ladies
know I was allowed to say it.
Live on Reminiscing with Gene DiNapoli, the worldwide premiere announcement. Peter Lemongello Jr. now with premier artist for your career. Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's great.
Yeah, it was really an honor to have somebody who's been around, you know, everybody, all the people that I really idolized and, you know, the highest level of show business.
Sure.
You know, managing the careers of people like that. Sure. And when he came to see me and, you know, he flipped and he just said, you know, boy, he says, you're the most talented thing I've seen in 40 years. And
wow,
you know, you're like right in the middle of all the people that I had. I see a little bit of all of them in you. That was mind blowing, especially because when he was coming to see me, I didn't really think that, you know, I don't do the crooner. I don't do Frank Sinatra. You know what I mean? That type of act. So I figured, you know, he might say, you know, you're very nice. You're, you know, good show. But I didn't think he would, you know, maybe, you know, appreciate or consider taking me on.
Right.
Because
right.
I'm doing rock and roll and Motown and all that, which is so different. But it was really an honor to.
Absolutely. You know. You've been around a few famous people in your life. We're going to show some pictures, Peter, and want you to tell us about them and maybe what. Maybe a little anecdote or a little quirk or a nice little story. First picture we're going to put up right now, it's you and I can't. I mean, these are two of the biggest names in music history. You want to introduce them, Peter?
Yes. Well, my buddy Chubby Checker.
Yeah.
And the lovely Miss Mary Wilson from the Supremes that we just lost this year. Yes. Which was very sad because, you know, I was supposed to work when last year I was going to be working with the Four Tops and we had Mary coming in for two of the shows. And then the pandemic broke out and we had to postpone it. So now we're starting to reschedule them. But it was really a big loss to the music world, the world in general, because she was such a lovely lady.
Right. You know, funny story. My wife graduated NYU University and Mary graduated the same year. She went back for her master's degree.
Wow.
And I got a great picture of my wife and her graduating together.
Yeah.
Something nice.
Chubby, like I said, he's a great guy. My dad's known him for a long, long time, but I talk to him all the time. When he comes down here and we go to the show, he always brings me on stage to do the twist with him.
Right. Anthony, picture number 10. Okay. That goes without saying.
That's a great moment in my life.
Yeah, that's some shot. Now is that Lawrence's son there?
Yes, that's Rocky, or Lawrence Payton Jr. And he's son of the original Four Top Lawrence Payton.
Sure. You know, for Duke to let you get that close and grab you that way, there's definitely a family feeling there.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
And it's great. It's really an honor to, you know, to be included like that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Next picture, Anthony. We go from the tops to the temps. And this is
Otis Williams,
the founding member, the last surviving member of the original lineup, the keeper of the Temptations flame, Otis Williams. Tell us, is he? I know on stage he's very soft spoken, Peter. Very soft spoken.
Yes.
Is he that way in real life, too?
Yeah, you know, kind of. Otis is a great guy, though. He really is. And, you know, I'm really honored. I'm really honored that he would allow me into his inner circle and to be, you know, such a, you know, friends with somebody like that. But yeah, I'll be seeing them in a couple weeks or no, next Saturday.
Right.
I'll be seeing them.
Weeks. One of the last pictures we have now. Is you with the most famous Italian American female pop artist of the 20th century, Connie Francis.
Yes.
That is a lovely picture. It looks like a few years ago.
That was actually just before the pandemic broke out.
Is that true?
Yes. That was last August, I guess.
Where was that? You know,
that was down here at our friend Tony Ferretti's 80th birthday party.
Wow. Cute story, if I may, Peter, about me and Connie. My dad was a very big gambler in Atlantic City. So one Halloween, Connie was playing at the Playboy Club, which turned into Bally's. Right. And I was a kid. I was maybe 15. And my father said, you know, you should let my son open up the show. And my father used to bring a lot of people down to Atlantic City with money. So they weren't going to tell him no. So I opened up the show for Connie Francis as Elvis when I was 15. Bally's was still called the Playboy. So later on that night, I got invited to her party. And she made a beautiful big fuss over me. Matter of fact, I got a great picture of me and her, which I'll show next week. People think it's Scott Baio, but it's actually me. It's actually in my opening montage, a picture of me and Connie. When you see these people, do you talk shop with them? Do you like, are you in awe still?
That's a good question. I guess to a degree, yes. I mean, but I'm fortunate that I've become friendly with a lot of them to the point that, you know, it's down to earth. You know what I mean? They're just people. So, I've been very blessed to get to know, meet and get to know and become friends with the people. Like, I love Fred Parris from the Five Satins.
Great guy, yes.
Great, yeah. Him and his wife are great people. And one of my closest friends, my dear friend that we lost earlier this year, was Lloyd Price. And he, you know, really like the pioneer of rock and roll, because a lot of people forget he came out before Little Richard. He came out before Fats Domino had any real hits. He was out before Chuck Berry. And a lot of the people, like Fats, they played for Lloyd before they were names themselves. So,
and more importantly, Peter, also a very astute businessman.
Yeah, absolutely. Very, very smart guy. I learned so much from him. And he always took me under his wing and really taught me a lot and, you know, helped guide me. But when he did his last two shows, which, you know, I booked him for my friend Harry G at the Kirby Center in Pennsylvania and then the State Theater in Jersey.
Right.
And that was March of 19. And those were the last two shows he did. But he was really great to the end. And, you know, it was just, it really was so cool to know him.
It's so sad. Not only that we've lost them so recently, is that I didn't think of doing a show like this until the pandemic hit. I wish I would have thought of this 5 years ago, when I could have interviewed all these great artists and given them, you know, so many other shows are out there, Peter, and they have four or five guests on at the same time. Everybody gets 10 minutes to talk. I don't do that. I give everybody 45, 50 minutes. I give them the proper respect that they've earned and that they deserve.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which is why I think my show is so well-liked, because people get to know a little bit more than if they just have 5 minutes.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, like you said, it's a shame we're losing and we've lost so many great legends the last couple of years. You know, one story that just came to mind was when I was with Lloyd and we were driving to from the first show in Pennsylvania, we were driving over to Jersey. So we were in the car and I said to him, you know, he discovered Little Richard actually. And so he was remained close with them through the years.
Right.
So I said, have you talked to Richard? Because he always talked to him. He said, no. He says, you know, let me give him a call. So he got Richard on the phone. And, you know, so me and him were talking to Little Richard. And I just said, I mean, what an experience to be driving in a car with Lloyd Price talking to Little Richard on the telephone.
That's an education you cannot pay for.
That's true.
You can't pay for that. Now, I know your dad was more of a balladeer, love song, standards type singer. Does he get a kick out of you with the rock and roll stuff and everything? Does he take to it pretty well?
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. Sometimes it gets him a little crazy. But when he comes to the show, he likes what I do. You know, I try to keep the show very exciting. So, you know, I try
to... Exciting. I think excitement is one of the key words in your show. And we're going to show just how excited you are, Peter Lemongello Jr. Anthony, let's do it with a little Jackie Wilson a la Lemongello Jr. Show love. I've been bending my ear. I've been on paper. Forevermore, you know you love the best that they find themselves. Higher and higher. I'm swinging, man. I'm swinging here in my basement. I love it. I love
Thank you.
It. So
yeah. No, I know my dad's proud of me, and the you know, he sees that the audience, the reaction from the audience. So, you know, he's happy with what I do. You know what I mean? Even though some of the songs might not be what his show right. was like.
Right.
But
you know, Pete, it's very easy to get somebody in the door out of curiosity. Your name goes up on a marquee. You play with the Tops, or you're playing on a concert on your own. Peter Lemongello Jr. Oh my God. I remember this kid's father back in the 70s. All right, let's go. But to get the people to come back time and time and time again is a testament to true talent. So tell us, what are people going to expect on the 12th and the 13th when you appear with your good friends, the Four Tops? What are people going to expect?
Well, a lot of excitement, you know, and a night of a lot of hits between the Tops singing their hits, and I'll be doing mainstream hits from that era. But I'm really excited because we have the 17-piece orchestra.
Wow.
Which is going to be backing me up, and I have background singers, and, you know, a lot of excitement. I'll be doing that Higher and Higher by Jackie Wilson and songs like that.
Yeah.
So it'll be exciting, and, you know, have to see my dance moves.
Okay. So do you have an opening song and a closing song that you always do, and everything else in the middle is just hot luck?
Well, I always close with Higher and Higher, and I have as an encore shout, which I can say I've been very fortunate that out of all the shows I've done, I always tell the band, listen, Higher and Higher might be the last song. We'll see how the audience reaction is, and you know, if it's not great, we'll end with that. But at every show so far, I've had to go into shout. So the audiences have really been, you know, receptive to my show and enthusiastic. So,
okay. What about an opening song?
For a while I was opening with a standard, which is the best things in life are free, but a more of a swing version of it. But now I'm opening with a song called Sweet Soul Music, which was written originally by Sam Cooke,
Arthur
even
Conley.
Though a lot of people know it by Arthur Conley.
Sure, sure. So I got to ask you this, and again, it's not racist. You're opening with an African-American song. You're closing with an African-American song. Do you do any white songs in the middle of your show?
Am I doing?
Okay, let me ask you this.
I think you're right on this, because I'm only doing a half hour, because you know it's the top show. Mm-hmm. When I do a full show myself, yeah, I have some, you know.
Do you do the Crest material when you're not with the Crest?
Yeah, well, I usually do 16 candles.
Okay.
Yeah, I usually do 16 candles. And I do a duet with my dad. I do I Love You in my long show. So
That's great.
But yeah, for the top show, I think you're kind of right about that.
Yeah.
Most of the exciting, you know, the exciting material. But
you know, we're working on bringing you and your dad to New York. We had discussed
right.
this. I would love to be the one to present it to the New York audience again, the return of Peter Lemongello with special guest Peter Lemongello Jr. It would just be an honor to do it. We're working on it. Things aren't moving as fast as we'd like.
Sure.
You know something, Pete? Looking at you, hearing you, watching you, you are lucky to have been molded by so many different facets. You are a throwback to the good old days of entertainment. And I think for that reason, your career, which has already been, what, how many years? Your career is 20 plus?
Well, not quite, but almost.
How old are you now?
22.
So you started when you were 3?
Yeah.
So your 19 plus year career is going to go into 69 year career. I got a feeling about this.
All right. Well, I don't want to rush it that quickly.
Well, not that quick. But we want to see you around for a long time. How are people going to get tickets to the Four Tops and Peter Lemongello Jr. show next week? Is there a website?
Yes, they can go to the Sunrise Theater, which is in Fort Pierce. They can go to their they could go to the box office in person, or you could go online, or you could call them from 10 to 2 weekdays. I believe they're open.
That's great.
So it's sunrisetheater.com is their website.
And the date again is?
Sunday, December the 12th.
Okay, so while I'm doing my doo-wop dinner up here, you're going to be down there keeping the great music alive with my favorite group of all time.
Yeah, I can't wait. It's, you know, it really is an honor. I remember last year, just before the pandemic, I was with the Tops and the Temps, and I was outside just with the lead singer of the Tops, and he's been there now a couple of years, but he was new at the time. He was only there about a year, and he said, he said, "You don't realize," he goes, "but you're the only one they'd let open for him." He says, "In the year I've been here," he says, "they don't let anybody open. They only work with the Temps." Said nobody else. He said, "That's how much they love you, that they're having you open."
What a compliment!
Yeah, it really, really was.
And
it really is, you know, an honor.
And on that note, there is no other way to close this show than with the words and the stamp of approval from the legendary Four Tops. Peter, I wish you the greatest of success from here on in, your show next week and your career.
Thank you.
Good luck with Premier Agency. Let him know.
Thank you.
Yeah, let him know I don't call agents. I call the artist directly, so I'll be dealing with you. Happy holidays to you, your family, your mom and dad. And thank you for felicitating next week's interview with Duke. It's going to be a cherry on my cake of 2021. I wish you the best. We'll talk, ladies and gentlemen, as we... Oh, your website. You have a website.
Yes, peterlemongellojr.com.
There you heard it. Straight from the horse's mouth, ladies and gentlemen. As we do each and every week, let's give this young man the way to go out, the way we do it all, our entertainers. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Peter Lemongello Jr. Thanks, Peter.
Thanks so much. Thanks for having me, Gene.
My pleasure. Happy holidays, pal.
Same to you.
Stay well. Wow, ladies and gentlemen, it's people like Peter and people like Chris that are going to keep this music alive for years and years to come. And right now, back to a word from our sponsors.
Hi, this is Francisco. Many people call me the creative CPA. If you need help with your taxes or financial matters, please email me your cell number and the best time and day to call you. You can email me at francisco@aol.com, and Cisco is spelled S-I-S-C-O, the creative CPA. It's that simple, that easy. Thank you.
Craving a cruise? Perhaps a gorgeous all-inclusive resort, magnificent destination weddings, and stunning, unforgettable honeymoons. Dream Destinations Travels, a cruise planner franchisee, has all your travel and vacation ideas covered with great deals, extensive knowledge, and totally flexible payment plans. Group travel, be it family or friends, is our specialty. Never a charge to our clients and always free, no-obligation quotes. Check our website at sundrenchcruises.com or give us a call, the number above.
Little Italy Auto Repair at 628 Crescent Avenue in the true Little Italy of the Bronx. Over 50 years of automotive service excellence, ASC and state certified, offering all types of services to all types of cars. Discounts to first responders, military, Fordham University students and faculty. All work is done by Victorio with the highest level of quality possible. Telephone number is 718-933-2365 or visit his website at www.littleitalyautobronx.webs.com. That's Little Italy Auto Repair. Thank you once again to our sponsors. Hopefully we can continue your support in the oncoming year. Don't forget, next week's show will be pre-recorded and aired 7 o'clock on Monday. It'll be our last show of 2021 with Duke Fahir of the world-famous Four Tops. Don't forget, next week, a bunch of shows. If you have nothing to do, Saturday, December 11th, call Nikki C. to go to a doo-wop spectacular at Stepanak High School in White Plains, New York. There's got to be, what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 7 great acts. on Sunday, a doo-wop dinner show at the Royal Regency Hotel in Yonkers, produced by yours truly, starring the Bel-Airs and Still in Style. $65 a ticket gets you dinner, tax and tip, and the show. Go to royalregencyshows.com to get your tickets. $65 includes tax and tip and a four-course meal. Then on Monday, December 13th, I'll be presenting the Italian Broadway Christmas show starring Anthony Nunziata and Regino DiCicco at the White Plains Performing Arts Center. Go to www.wppac.com for your tickets. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's episode 58. We got one more. Hopefully you can join us. We won't be able to answer comments because the show will be pre-recorded. But we are going to go live with it on the 7th. I want to thank each and every one of you for being with me the past year and a half, year and 3 months. I started this out of boredom because I thought that people still needed to be entertained. It has grown into something I love, and I work very hard at it. You have no idea the amount of emails, pictures, videos that myself, my producer Anthony, go through each and every week to bring you the best in what we consider entertainment. We're going to be looking for a lot of other guests. So if you happen to know somebody in the arts and you want them to be interviewed, just send them my way. Follow my page, Reminiscing with Gene DiNapoli. Go to my website, GeneDiNapoli.com, or send me an email at GeneDiNapoli@gmail.com. And if we don't see you, may you all have a blessed and wonderful holiday season. Keep your chin up, but keep it guarded. We will get through everything with flying colors. Once again, I love you. God bless you. And God bless America.